Welcome back. Tom Hartman here with you, and Mike Papantonio on the line with us, host of Ring of Fire Radio, ringoffireradio.com, the website. Hey, Pap, welcome back.
Tom, how are you?
I am great, but I'll get better. How about you, my friend?
Good.
So, boy, there's a lot going on since the last time we talked a week or so ago. The Supreme Court today, I think if there was ever a case that illustrates the insanity of Marbury v. Madison, today was that case.
Yes.
The Supreme Court, I mean, the original case in this is, as Shane O'Farnon, our Supreme Court reporter, who was in the Supreme Court this morning when this came down, as pointed out by Justice Ginsburg, the original case was an objection that shouldn't have even had standing. The original case was simply, you know, they did not demonstrate that they were harmed by this law. All they demonstrated was that they didn't like it.
Well, they reached, you saw them do the same thing with Citizens United, where they reach out for the opportunity to be able to review because they know that they can cause more harm. But this case, I think people are looking at and not understanding kind of the underpinning of it. This is truly a corporate America kind of ruling that comes from the corporate America go-to guys on the Supreme Court there, the five that always rule for corporate America. Here's how it works. Corporate America, it's very clear. If you look at anything written by the Chamber of Commerce, created by Associated Industries, they have a direct benefit in keeping Republicans in office. This is not me talking. This has been study after study where they go back and they say, where does corporate America line up politically? Is it blue or is it red? And the reason it's red is because they're always there to bail corporate America out. So these judges that ruled this are there because of corporate America. They rule in favor of corporate America probably in the neighborhood of 90. I've seen anywhere between 92 to 95% of the time. So tying that up, we understand this. If Democrats win, corporate America loses. That's the notion of how corporate America views elections. They don't really care about the social issues. They care how does it affect the bottom line. Add to that, Tom, the demographics changes with Latinos, with African Americans, with young voters. All of a sudden, it becomes very important for this U.S. Supreme Court to empower the red states, or all states now, to be able to keep voters from going to the polls. So when you take Section 4 out of all this, Section 5 becomes irrelevant. And for the U.S. Supreme Court to suggest, well, gee whiz, these Section 5 predicates are ridiculous, they have to be revisited. Well, no, they're not ridiculous. As a matter of fact, the Senate and Congress reviewed them for days and weeks and months on end, and they took in testimony, hours and days of testimony, where it became very apparent to them that racism is still alive and well in these suspect jurisdictions like Florida, like Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia, Texas, South Carolina, where you would expect it. They said, we're so concerned but that we want this law to stay intact until 2031 because the experts came in and testified in front of Congress and said, we don't see any dramatic change until there's a demographic change.
Right.
So this is the Supreme Court.
15,000 pages of testimony.
Right. So the Supreme Court now comes to the aid. And again, you have to look at this through their eyes. These are corporatist judges. Take the ideology out of it, Tom. Take Republican ideology out of it, except for this fact. Corporate America requires that Republicans be in office. And this is a court that has always done the bidding for corporate America, as we've seen on the other decisions that they reached in the last week. It's deplorable decisions.
Paul Weyrich was the guy who co-founded the American Legislative Exchange Council. ALEC, was one of the founders, I believe, of the Heritage Foundation, certainly was there for that era. The Cato Institute, I mean, all the, and it was in charge of the direct mail for the Reagan campaign in the 1980 election. One of the founders of the modern Republican Party. And in the fall of 1980, as Ronald Reagan is running for president, Paul Weyrich spoke to a group of Republican Christian activists in a church in Dallas, Texas. Here's what he had to say that has now reached super fulfillment in the Supreme Court today. Here's Paul Weyrich.
Now, many of our Christians have what I call the goo-goo syndrome. Good government. They want everybody to vote. I don't want everybody to vote. Elections are not won by a majority of people. They never have been from the beginning of our country, and they are not now. As a matter of fact, our leverage in the elections, quite candidly, goes up as the voting populace goes down.
You can bet that these five Supreme Court justices are well aware of Weyrich's position. But again, Sam, I think what's so important is not to miss the connection. We look at everything from political ideology. We say, gee whiz, I'm Democrat, therefore I have these ideological values. You're Republican, therefore you have these ideological values. But the most salient value that this court is trying to protect is the corporate ideology. And they do that by keeping this new demographic shift from taking place, by keeping people from voting.
Yeah. And speaking of the corporate demographic, we've got a foreign, a Canadian corporation. An interesting story I was reading this morning. They've at an 8,000-foot elevation in Utah, I believe it is, there's another Canadian corporation called U.S. something or other, something like U.S. Energy, but they got U.S. in the name, but it's a Canadian corporation digging up oil sands, tar sands,
yeah,
in Utah. But you got this TransCanada with the Keystone Pipeline. President Obama mentioned today that he would veto it if it was determined that it wasn't in the national interest. Actually, that he would approve it if it was in the national interest and it didn't increase net carbon emissions. And the State Department, I believe, has already issued a preliminary report basically saying it is in the national interest and it doesn't raise carbon emissions.
Right.
So
yeah, writing's on it. Tom, you probably wouldn't like what I have to say about what I observed about the speech that Obama gave.
I think I might have just shared it with you.
Okay. Well, so having said that, we can't miss the story behind the story. Look, this is an administration that has allowed the oil industry to not only resume, to speed up the permitting process for deep water drilling. It's a president that caved in on MACT, which is M-A-C-T, that's to reduce emissions of mercury and arsenic that reaches our children's lungs from virtually every power plant in the country. It's an administration that has embraced fracking. It's an administration that we still don't know why he won't just come out and say, look, I'm going to permit Keystone to take place, that we've been strung on. And so it's an administration that we've missed something here. And they've used the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs very, very astutely, Tom. Every time this administration has even come out with something that looks like an executive order, it's been pitched over to the OIRA, and it falls into a black hole. It disappears. It disappears for years. Matter of fact, there's about 120 rulemaking kind of decisions that have come not just from this administration, but all the way back to Bush, that have sat in this black hole called the OIRA.
What is the OIRA?
It's called the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs. It is the place where an administration is able to do this. Here's how it works. The administration goes on the air and they say, you know, I feel your pain. I'm there for you. I want this change to take place. And what they actually end up doing is they may sign in a law, but then they say, we're going to have to send it over to OIRA for a review. And they take hearings. They can delay it forever. It is a black hole, and what this allows is for industry to come in and pitch their side of the story and delay any.
So this is the equivalent of lobbying Congress.
Well, of course.
Only they're lobbying the White House about executive orders.
Well, that's exactly right. It also comes from Congress too. Bills come out of Congress, and this is kind of a safe haven for a president who says, gee whiz, I've done everything I'm supposed to do. The OIRA has it. I don't know what's happening. But my point being, Tom, this is an administration who's talked a lot about real change, and I haven't really seen it yet.
We're all holding our breath here, Pat. Or maybe we shouldn't be. I don't know.
Hopeful.
Yeah,
I'm hopeful too. I am hopeful.
You know, I thought, okay, he's after the election. You know, he's got nothing to lose now. Well, we'll see. We'll see. He still hasn't made a decision on Keystone. So, Mike Papantonio, ringoffireradio.com. We'll be right back.